Hi everyone. In the previous videos, we started to define the Scala functional subset, which offers powerful refactoring capabilities and pushes us to write code that is simpler to test. In exchange, we need to restrict ourselves to FP functions and ignore null entirely. Today, we'll cover the last restriction on this list, which concerns runtime reflection. First of all, what is it? If you look at the documentation, it will say something like, reflection is the ability of a program to inspect and possibly modify itself. This means that we have access to lots of metadata about all the objects we manipulate. For example, here I define a case class, robot, with a single method that moves it either forward or backward. Then once we have the value of robot, we can use reflection to list all the methods available. There are quite a few more than expected. Equals, toString, and hashcode, which are defined on all types in Scala. Copy, because it's a case class. Position and direction, one for each field. And finally move, the only method that we specified ourselves. There are even more methods available that I haven't listed here. We can also use reflection to call methods on an object. Here we look up a method by name and then invoke it. We can also use reflection to create an instance of a class. This capability is often used by dependency injection frameworks such as Spring or Geis, which are quite common in Java but almost non-existent in Scala. It's also worth noting that there are two types of reflections, which differ depending on when they execute: runtime reflection and compile-time reflection. The latter is also called macros, but it's beyond the scope of this course, both because it's a very advanced topic and because the API changes completely between Scala 2 and Scala 3. So there is little point in covering Scala 2 macros now that Scala 3 is available. So today, we'll only be looking at runtime reflection, which is a very dangerous feature. Not only it can easily throw exception, but even worse, reflection lets us bypass all the abstractions and safeguards set by the language. Let me show you. You might be aware that an immutable list in Scala uses mutation under the hood. If you open the Scala standard library and check for the code of column-column, you will see that the field storing the tail of the list is a mutating variable. This is done for performance reasons. Otherwise, every time we map over a list, we would need to iterate twice. The first time to modify the list and another time to reverse it. But this is an implementation detail. The authors of the standard library may decide to use a different implementation, and nothing outside of the class list should be affected. This is why the field is private. However, when using reflections, these guarantees no longer hold. We could look up a variable by name, make it visible, and then update the tail of the list. In other words, we could mutate an immutable list. Fortunately, just as with null, runtime reflection is rare in Scala. We almost never use it, at least not directly. That said, there is one important Scala feature that is powered by reflection. And if we're not careful, it can easily lead to bugs or bad design decisions. I'm talking about pattern matching. Here, I've defined a function that takes a value of type any. Any is the biggest possible type in Scala. Every type extends any. And this function checks if the input is an int or a double using pattern matching. If it is one of these, we increment the number by one. Otherwise, we do nothing. Behind the scenes, every case statement is rewritten using reflection. We first check if the value has type int or double using is instance of. Then we downcast the value to the corresponding type using as instance of. In the generic chapter, we saw that isInstanceAuth is unreliable when the type contains a type parameter, such as option or list. For example, if we add a case statement for an option of int, then increment works as expected for sum of 1, but it blows up at runtime if we call it with sum of hello. This is because isInstanceAuth cannot distinguish between an option of int and an option of string. At runtime, they are both the same due to type erasure. So we shouldn't pattern match on a type containing a type parameter and differentiate based on the value of this parameter. Now, there is another situation where we also need to be cautious, but it's quite subtle. So I would like to take a small detour as I would like to present you with a realistic example. Here I define a trait used to authenticate users in our application. Auth has a single method, authenticate, which takes a token and eventually produces a user if the token is valid. Authenticate will most likely contact an external system, maybe a database or a third-party provider. So it's not an FP function. But let's forget about this for now, as we'll cover how to perform actions in the next chapter. Then we define two implementations of Auth. The first one, OctaAuth, uses a REST client to connect to Okta, a popular third-party authentication provider. The second, MockAuth, uses an in-memory map to store the users with their token. OctaAuth is used in production to connect to our external authentication provider, while MockAuth is used for testing or when we run the application locally. Now, let's say we want to incorporate Auth into our REST API. A common way to do this is to build a middleware. An HTTP server is basically a function that accepts an HTTP request and returns an HTTP response. In this context, a middleware is something that we insert in between the initial request and the final response. For example, here I've defined one that adds a header to all responses. In our use case, we may want to define a middleware that authenticates a user and passes it down to the next layer. The code should look like this. First, we check the authorization header from the HTTP request and extract the token. If we can't find it, we reject the request, returning an HTTP error called forbidden. If we do find the token, then we pass it to the authenticate function. Once the authentication process returns the user, we call the method provide to pass the user to the next HTTP layer. This is pseudocode, but it's almost the same API as in the AKA HTTP library, so it's not too far from what we would do in a real code base. Now, let's imagine we are concerned about accidentally releasing a version of our application into production with hard-coded test users. That's a legitimate concern, because in practice, we often determine which class to instantiate based on a config file. For example, our production config might use the third-party provider, while our local config will use a set of hard-coded test users. Now, it's easy to accidentally copy-paste the wrong config from one file to another. Therefore, we have decided to update the Auth middleware so that if we use the MockAuth class in production, then all HTTP requests will be rejected with an error. To do this, we'll first add an extra parameter to the middleware to encode the environment. It can either be local, UAT, or prod. Then in the body of the function, we pattern match on the environment and on the Auth variable. If we are in production and use an instance of the MockAuth class, then we return an HTTP error called internal server error. Otherwise, we do exactly the same as before. Great, so it works. We can rest assured that, you know, if we screw up with the config file, then at least nobody will be able to log in with hard-coded test credentials. Now, imagine a few months pass and our application becomes much more popular. Our request volume has increased and we encounter a bottleneck in the authentication layer. A typical solution is to cache the request to authenticate. We'll first check if the token is in the local cache and hasn't expired. If that's the case, then we return the user without contacting the Auth provider, which should be very fast. Otherwise, we do send the request to the Auth provider, and then we update the cache. In practice, this means that we'll need to create a new Auth implementation, called cached Auth, that contains two fields. One, the in-memory cache, and two, the real Auth implementation that we'll use as a fallback option if the token is not in the cache. Cool, so it works like a charm. Our application is back to manageable load. Great work, everyone. However, one thing we didn't notice is that we introduced a bug in the Auth middleware. Let's go back to it. What would happen if in production we used a cached authorization with an underlying mock? Then the first case statement will not match because the Auth value is not an instance of the class mockAuth. It's an instance of the class cacheAuth. Our logic was supposed to detect mock implementation of the Auth interface. But once we wrap mockAuth inside a cacheAuth, we lose this information. This bug is tricky to detect because the Auth interface and the Auth middleware are entirely separate pieces of code. They might even reside in different packages or libraries and be maintained by different developers. This example demonstrates why we should avoid pattern matching on an open trait. Traits by default are meant to be extended. They define a contract, and as long as an instance satisfies this contract, then we should accept them. If we don't follow this rule and start picking under the hood, we break encapsulation. This is the same principle as we use when defining a private variable or method inside a class. We know it's there, but we tell the rest of the program to forget about it. We could use reflection to bypass this restriction, but that would make our program very difficult to evolve and test. The same rule goes for pattern matching on an open class. Now, the main issue is that it feels wrong to use reflection to modify a private variable. The API is complicated, and we rarely see that kind of code in practice. However, we pattern match on values all the time for entirely valid reasons. So it's difficult to distinguish between a safe and unsafe use of pattern matching. However, there is a rule of thumb to figure it out. If a class or trait is final, sealed, a case class or a case object, or a primitive like int or boolean, then it is safe to pattern match because our code is tightly coupled to this class. If this class were to change in the future, we would want to get a compiler error or a warning so that we are forced to review the logic that depends on it. This is why we should use exhaustive pattern matching as much as possible to get help from the compiler. Now, if the class or trait is abstract, open, this is a new keyword in Scala 3, or without any modifier, then we should not use pattern matching because our code is loosely coupled to this class. In other words, we only depend on the public contract that this class exposes, rather than on the exact implementation. Let's get back to the authentication example so that I can show you what I mean by contract. If the Auth trait had a slightly different interface, one including a revoke method that accepts a token and invalidates it, we could add some documentation to describe the interaction between the revoke and authenticate methods. For example, we could say that if we call revoke with a valid token, then authenticate will return none. The token is now invalid. Better still, we could encode this contract with a test suite so that we can easily verify that any implementation of Auth behaves as expected. The key point here is that if we write some logic that takes an Auth interface, we should accept any implementation which satisfies the Auth contract. By the way, this recommendation is not specific to functional programming. You might have heard it in object-oriented programming as well, where experts recommend coding against the interface and not the implementation. It's often perceived that functional programming forces you to unlearn everything in order to follow the FP way. Some areas definitely need adapting, but many patterns and engineering practices remain very much the same. A good idea in OOP is often a good idea in FP, and vice versa. For instance, dependency injection or coding against the interface are best practices in general. So today we have seen that runtime reflection is probably the most powerful technique in Scala. We can use it to bypass all safeguards and abstractions defined in the language. Therefore, the only sensible way to deal with such a dangerous feature is to treat it as we treat null. We simply ignore it and never use it directly. The only issue is that reflection is used to implement pattern matching, and as a result, some pattern matching usages are dangerous. Today we saw two examples. The first was pattern matching on types with type parameter. The second was pattern matching on classes meant for extension, when they have an abstract or open keyword, or no keyword at all, since in Scala all classes are open by default. Scala 3 will bring some changes in this area, such as a new type called Matchable, which controls when we can pattern match on a value. As a first step, every type, except any, will extend Matchable. This means that the code we saw earlier will produce a warning in Scala 3. This is a significant step forward, because it will discourage pattern matching on all types. And I hope that over time, Scala will remove Matchable from other types, so that we won't have to learn all the pitfalls that I've shown you today. Ideally, we should be able to rely on the compiler to let us know whether the usage is safe or not. Cool, so I hope you enjoyed this video, and don't forget to check out the notes for more information and solution to the Auth middleware example. See you soon. Don't forget to check out my website, fp-tower.com, to get access to all my functional programming content and sign up for my course. See you soon.